Hi, I'm Eric Schmidt, and this is Video Voters Guide, a service of the League of Women Voters, a 100-year-old nonpartisan organization that believes democracy depends on informed and active participation. For more election information, be sure to visit our online site, Vote 411, that's V-O-T-E 411, before you mark your ballot for the May 19th Oregon primary election. Today, we have Shamia Fagan. She is a candidate for the Democratic Party's nomination for Oregon Secretary of State. Ms. Fagan, thank you for joining us. We appreciate your participation.
I'm happy to be
here. Senator Fagan. I should say Senator Fagan because you're still in the Oregon legislature. So tell us a little bit about yourself and why you want to get out of the legislature and become Secretary of State.
Thank you, Eric. So I actually grew up in rural Oregon. So I grew up in Duffer and the Dalles. My dad was a single parent, raising three kids. I have two older brothers by himself out there in rural Oregon. And my mom battled meth and heroin addiction for most of my life and was homeless in Portland. And one time we went to visit her, pulled up to this big, beautiful, kind of Victorian style house with a big wraparound porch. And my brother, who had driven me to see her, we walked around to the front steps, but instead of walking up the steps, mom dropped to her knees and crawled under the porch. And then she invited us into her home. And so my brother and I dropped to all fours and crawled under the porch behind her. And she had a box that she kept with her that was full of pictures of us and letters from us. And I've reflected back on that. And I know that that box for her meant that even on her darkest days, an ordinary life was within reach. And so she could fight for it. And when she passed away in October of 2014, she had been clean for almost 6 years, and she was living in the first house she'd ever owned, a little bungalow in Umatilla, Oregon. And that has been a guiding light of my legislative service. I'm also a civil rights attorney, is that people are fighting just to get to an ordinary life. They're fighting just for the stability and the basic provisions they need. And so I have focused my service as a school board member, a member of the Oregon State House, and currently a member of the Oregon State Senate on making government and the services we provide accessible and dropping barriers. That's why as a freshman legislator, Eric, I was one of the group that sat down with then Secretary of State Kate Brown to map Oregon's path to automatic voter registration, the motor voter law that we then passed 2 years later. And in my current term in the Oregon Senate, I was instrumental in helping Oregon join the National Popular Vote Compact so that a Republican in Eastern Oregon's vote counts just as much in a presidential election as a voter in Michigan or Ohio or Florida, and also made sure that we have prepaid postage on our ballots, which looks pretty prescient right about now in the midst of a global pandemic, that Oregonians are not going to have to go to the store and find a place to buy stamps in order to turn in their ballot, that every single mailbox in Oregon is a ballot box. So I've been leading on issues that relate to the Secretary of State's office since I showed up through the legislature 8 years ago, and I'm happy to continue leading on those as Oregon's next Secretary of State.
What's your take on all of the problems that some of the Eastern Republicans have with Oregon's vote-by-mail system?
Well, it's disgraceful. And one of the questions we've been asked a lot in this campaign is, should Oregon's Secretary of State, which right now, of course, is a partisan office, partisanship in the simple description, meaning you get elected to a particular from a particular party. I'm running for the Democratic primary. And I think that there's been a lot of folks who've asked, well, shouldn't the Secretary of State just be nonpartisan? And I think if you're looking back on the days of Norma Paulus and Tom McCall and Mark Hatfield, you might think, sure, because the party's differences at that point in time weren't about access to voting. They were about different issues. But right now, what we're seeing nationally from the president down to Republican-led states is an actual part of the Republican platform being anti-democracy, being trying to reduce people from being able to vote, voter suppression. And so right now, you literally see Democratic states and Democratic legislatures and Democratic governors trying to expand voting rights. And you see Republican states and our Republican president trying to suppress voting. And so now more than ever, it matters that our Secretary of State here in Oregon belongs to a political party that's seeking to expand democracy, not one seeking to destroy it.
Aside from the partisanship, is there anything that can be done to make Oregon's voting system more resilient and safe?
Sure. Well, we can be proud in Oregon that people fill out their ballots, you know, by marking with a blue or black pen, they mail those in, paper ballots, that those paper ballots are then kept for in the event that we need any recounts or audits. So Oregonians can be very proud of the way that we do our voting system. But a couple of improvements that we could make is, number one, end the confusion that happens in Oregon over that last weekend. Eric, you know what I'm talking about, where every news station starts to say, is it too late to mail your ballot? Now it's too late to mail your ballot. And depending on if you're in the metro area or a highly populated area versus a rural area, you maybe can mail your ballot on a different day. Because of course, here in Oregon, in order to count in the election, the ballot has to be received by election day, whereas other states that have vote by mail have done the ballot has to be mailed or postmarked by election day. That's a simple fix that we need to do here in Oregon to eliminate that confusion that happens in that last weekend before election day. I'm a believer that the data shows that voter confusion equals voter suppression, even if it's not intentional, and we need to make that change here in Oregon. But in terms of cybersecurity, our balloting system is very secure. There is an effort under the current Secretary of State to experiment with voting by apps. And I completely oppose that because there's a pilot project going on. But the reality is the hackers aren't going to hack the pilot project. They're going to wait till the pilot project looks well and we begin to rely on it before any hacking would occur. But more importantly, it's our Oregon voter registration system, because we do allow online voter registration, that's where our biggest security risks are. There was an audit in 2019 through the chief information officer in the Secretary of State's office on what we can do to bolster our cybersecurity around our voter registration system. Because of course, whether or not Oregonians actually receive that ballot in the mail is based on whether or not they're listed as an active registered voter in our voter registration system. So we need to make sure that is secure, because that's the pipeline through which Oregonians actually get their ballots.
What are your thoughts on the legislative referral that would allow limits on political campaign contributions and expenditures and ensure that campaign advertisements contain information on who paid for them?
Oh, I love that. The reality is we got to get our big money out of politics. Oregonians are clamoring for this. Oregon is the wild, wild west when it comes to campaign contributions. We saw that in the most recent governor's race, where one person was able to give, I think, $3.5 million to one candidate in an election. That is absurd, and Oregonians know that's absurd. And so I absolutely support the referral. First off, we have to actually amend the Oregon Constitution. A lot of Oregon voters say to me, why don't we already have limits? Well, there was a Supreme Court case, an Oregon Supreme Court case, decades ago that essentially invalidated campaign limits that had existed at that time. So what Oregonians are going to see this November on their ballot is a constitutional referral to Oregonians to amend our constitution to allow statutory campaign finance limits. So absolutely, we need to limit the, you need to actually have a certain amount by which anybody that's giving to a campaign can only give a certain amount, whether they're a giant corporation or a mom and pop business or a random family that wants to give. There needs to be a contribution limit. But I think a key here is to not punish grassroots organizations that inspire people to give to their small donor packs, to make sure that on the right, you often have Oregon Right to Life or the Oregon Firearms Federation. On the left, you often have, you know, Moms Demand Action or the Oregon League of Conservation Voters or Planned Parenthood. These are grassroots organizations that inspire their donors to give and pitch in little bits of money. So I do think there should be an exception for small donor PACs that are out there and they're raising money, but nobody is giving more than that contribution limit to those PACs. Those grassroots organizations should be able to band together to make sure that they're still able to raise up the issues that are supported by thousands and thousands of Oregonians through giving through a small donor PAC.
We have about a minute left, so I just want to warn you about that. But as you know, redistricting will take place in Oregon next year. What are your thoughts on the pending initiative petition that would assign that task to an independent commission and take it away from the legislature and the Secretary of State?
Yeah, two concerns about the commission. Number one is there's no accountability. The legislature or the Secretary of State, under our current law, we can be fired if Oregonians don't like the job that we do. With this appointed commission, Oregonians don't have the ability to actually hold people accountable. And the second one is that the concern is more about competitive districts than it is about representation. Eric, it's no coincidence that in 2016, the Oregon legislature welcomed the most diverse class of freshman legislators ever. Legislators that are finally starting to look like Oregon, folks from different communities and Black and Indigenous and people of color in Oregon, finally seeing a legislature that starts to reflect them and their families and communities. We don't want to go backwards by saying, well, those were safe districts, so we need to make every district competitive. When we talk about going back to competitiveness, we have to remember the Oregon legislature used to be overwhelmingly male and overwhelmingly white, and we don't want to go back to that. The cornerstone of redistricting should be representation. One person, one vote, and that would be my cornerstone if I ever had to be involved in redistricting.
In 30 seconds, do you like campaigning virtually or would you rather be out shaking hands?
I'd rather do it all. Campaigns are always about meeting people where they're at. And right now they're at home and they're on their computers and they're on their TVs. And we're going to meet Oregonians where they are. And I look forward to the day. My fifth time running for office in Oregon, Eric, I've never lost. And I look forward to getting back to shaking hands or bumping elbows, but happy to meet Oregonians where they are.
Shamia Fagan is running for the Democratic Party nomination for Oregon Secretary of State. Thank you for joining us. The League of Women Voters really appreciate your participation. And I'm Eric Schmidt. Don't forget, vote 411 for your personal ballot information from the League of Women Voters. Thanks for watching.